Hello everyone, welcome to Datafuse Analytics. Today we will be learning an important but a complex topic called as Variational Autoencoders. But don't worry guys, I have tried my best to simplify this topic for you, including the mathematics behind it. And yes, everything will be explained in an intuitive manner. Before understanding the actual Variational Autoencoders, we must first understand the limitations and problems with Vanilla Autoencoders. The first important problem with vanilla autoencoder is that we can observe gaps in the latent space where none of the images are represented. Now, these gaps make sense as distinct encodings for each image type make it far easier for the decoder to decode them. Now, this is fine if we are just replicating the same images. But as a generative model, you don't want the model to prepare or to replicate the same image that you put in. So, we want to randomly sample from the latent space or generate variations of an input image from a continuous latent space. The second problem with autoencoder is that it is not even guaranteed that points will be centered around 0,0. Now, this makes sampling our latent space problematic. The third limitation is that each instance is mapped directly to one point in the latent space, as we can see in this diagram. The next limitation is latent space might not be continuous or easy for interpolation. Now, we will be seeing these problems getting solved during implementation of variational autoencoders too. But first, let's study what exactly is variational autoencoder theoretically. Now, we will try to address and solve the limitations of vanilla autoencoders using variational autoencoders. Now, in variational autoencoder, each image is instead mapped to a multivariate normal distribution around a point in the latent space. Variational autoencoders stand out from vanilla autoencoders due to one key feature that greatly enhances their usefulness in generative modeling. This feature is that the variational autoencoder latent space are inherently continuous, enabling straightforward random sampling and interpolation. Now, to accomplish this, variational autoencoder employ an unconventional approach. Instead of having encoder produce single encoding vector of size n, it generates two separate vectors, one for mean and another for standard deviation, that is mu and sigma. Then the assumption is that variational autoencoders assume that there is no correlation between dimensions in the latent space. So this is all about theoretical part of variational autoencoder. Now, you might be confused, like what is this mean and what is standard deviation, right? Now, let me simplify this mean vector and standard deviation for you all before moving ahead with this variational autoencoder. In simple terms, the mean vector determines the central point for encoding an input, and standard deviation determines how much the encoding can deviate from that central point. We can see here in this particular diagram. Now, let's quickly go through the architecture of this variational autoencoder. So, I'll try to cover each and every block. First off, let's cover the decoder part. Now, the decoder of variational autoencoder is identical to what we studied in the plain or vanilla autoencoder. So, we will not touch that decoder part as we have already studied that. Okay. The main important changes in variational autoencoder is made in the encoder part. Now, we need to tweak the encoder part in VAE model architecture or in variational autoencoder model architecture. Now, variance values are inherently positive, right? Which is why we opt to represent them using logarithm, which can cover the entire real number spectrum for negative infinity to positive infinity. Now, this approach enables us to employ a neural network as encoder to transform input images into both mean and logarithmic variance vector. So, in brief, the encoder processes the input images to produce two vectors, namely Z mean and Z logarithmic of variance. Now, these vectors jointly describe a multivariate normal distribution in the latent space, where this Z mean represents the distribution's mean point and Z logarithmic variance represents the logarithmic variance of each dimension. And this Z, we can generate a sample point known as Z from the distribution defined by this equation, like Z equals Z mean plus Z sigma into epsilon. But how this change in this encoder works, like why are we using Z logarithmic variance and Z mean? We will see it now. Vanilla autoencoders, we observed that the latent space was not continuous. For instance, if a point -5,3, just for an example, decoded into a recognizable image of a t-shirt, then there is no guarantee that -5.1 and 3.1 would produce something similar. However, with this current approach of variational autoencoder, when we sample around Z mean, the decoder must ensure that nearby points yield very similar decoder images. Now, this ensures that reconstruction loss stays minimal or it stays very small. Now, it is a very important property of variational autoencoder, and it is a cool property, I can say. Now, because it means that even if we select a point in latent space that decoder hasn't encountered before while training, it is likely to generate a well-formed image. So, in simple terms, think of mean vector as determining where the encoding of an input should be centered in the latent space, and the standard deviation as governing how much variation is allowed from that center. Now, when encodings are randomly generated within this circle of distribution, the decoder learns that not only one specific point in the latent space represents a particular class, but also the nearby points represent the same class. And that's why this circle is important. Now, this enables the decoder to handle not just individual distinct encodings in the latent space, but also encodings that exhibit slight variations. This is possible because the decoder is trained with a range of variations of the same inputs encoding. So, this is a very cool property of variational autoencoder. Now, the goal of this variational autoencoder is to have encodings that are both very similar and distinct from each other. And this facilitates smooth interpolation and creation of new samples. Now, how to achieve this kind of distribution? So, let's welcome a new loss function. Now, to achieve this, the aim that we discussed in the previous slide, we incorporate something called as KL divergence loss or Kullback-Leber divergence loss. This KL divergence measures the difference between two probability distributions. And by minimizing this KL divergence loss, here what we are doing is we are essentially fine-tuning the probability distribution parameters, that is mu and sigma, to closely match those of the target distribution. Now, I have this one doubt in mind, can we have just this KL divergence loss and not reconstruction loss? Let's see why we need to have both reconstruction and KL divergence loss. Now, when we use only this KL divergence loss, the latent space might end up with encodings which are scattered randomly near its center. Now, without even considering the similarity among nearby encodings, this makes it difficult for the decoder to extract meaningful information. Now, simply because there are really isn't any meaning in this particular cluster, right? However, when we optimize both KL divergence loss and reconstruction loss, it creates a latent space where nearby encodings are similar, forming clusters on a local scale. At the same time, globally, the encoders are densely packed near the origin of the latent space. This combination allows for both local clustering and a global structure in the latent space, making it more useful for generating meaningful data. And we will be seeing this type of cluster during implementation too. So in this way, the variational autoencoder works. Now, this is a bonus slide, and I want you all to know about something called as the reparameterization trick. Rather than directly sampling from a normal distribution with parameters Z mean and Z logarithmic variance, we take a different approach. Now, we first sample a random value epsilon from a standard distribution with mean 0 and variance as 1. Then what we do is, we adjust the sample manually to have the desired mean and variance using the formula Z equals Z mean plus Z log variance into epsilon that we have already seen. Now, this technique is called as reparameterization trick, and it is very important and significant because it enables gradients to flow backward throughout the layer during training. By keeping all the randomness within the variable epsilon, the partial derivative of the layer's output with respect to its input remains deterministic. What I mean to say is, it is not dependent on the random epsilon. Now, this deterministic property is very crucial for allowing backpropagation throughout the layer, which is essential for training neural network efficiently. In essence, or to summarize this, the reparameterization trick separates the randomness introduced by the stochastic layer from the deterministic computation of gradients, making it possible to train models with such layers effectively. So this is everything with respect to variational autoencoders theoretical part. If you have watched this video till now, please like this video and share with all our data science enthusiasts. In the next session, I'll be actually implementing variational autoencoders in Python. So subscribe to the channel. Bye bye guys. Take care.